Let everyone stand for the pledge.
My chair's wet, Dan.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I pledge allegiance
to the Christian flag and to the Savior of the kingdom of saints, one Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again, with life and liberty to all who believe.
I pledge
allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and will hide its words in my heart, that I might not sin against God.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign God, would He be held at sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I had done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Well might the sun in darkness lie, and shine his glories in, when Christ the mighty Maker died, for man the creature's sin. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Myself away. nothing but the blood of Jesus for my cleansing this my plea. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Nothing can
for sin atone.
Gone be before us like the rain, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary, their lives a stirring testament to God's sustaining grace. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race, not only for but as those who've gone before us, let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly love. Our children sift through all we've left behind. May the clues that they discover, the memories they uncover, become the light that leads them through the road we each must find. Only all who come behind us find us faithful.
Chapter 18, Judgment upon the Sinful. I'm going to try to be expedient tonight and get you out of here a little bit early if we can. We got business meeting tonight. I don't think look like there's enough here to start a fight or at least stop it, so it should be short and sweet. Jeremiah chapter 18, I'm going to forego the reading of the announcements. If you'd like to know those, you missed them this morning, grab a bulletin, they're all in there. Jeremiah chapter 18, verses 11 through 17, it says, "Now therefore go to, speak to the men of Judah and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, saying, Thus saith the Lord, Behold, I frame evil against you, and devise a device against you. Return ye now, every one, from his evil way, and make your ways and your doings good. And they said, There is no hope, but we will walk after our own devices, and we will do And we will, every one, do the imagination of his evil heart. Therefore, thus saith the Lord, Ask ye now among the heathen, Who Who has heard such things? The virgin of Israel hath done a very horrible thing. Will a man leave the snow of Lebanon, which cometh from the rock of the field? Or shall the cold flowing waters that come from another's place be forsaken? Because my people hath forgotten me, they have burned incense to vanity, and they have caused them to stumble in their ways from the ancient paths, to walk in paths, in a way not cast up, to make their land desolate, and a perpetual hissing. Every one that passeth thereby shall be astonished and wag his head. I will scatter them as with an east wind before the enemy. I will show them the back and not the face in the day of their calamity. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the reading of your word today. And Father, thank you again for such a beautiful day. I thank you again today, Father, for our mothers and the honor that we bestow upon them this day. And Father, we ask you today that you would hide me behind the cross tonight, Father. Once again, Father, lift the curtain, let us see into your presence. And Father, we'll be careful to give you the praise and the glory. Help me to stay attuned to the scriptures tonight, Father. Lord, help me to listen to the power of the Spirit. And Father, you nudge me when we're done. And Father, we'll be careful to give you the praise and all the glory. For we ask it in the blessed name of Jesus. For his sake we pray. Amen. Amen. The scripture tonight was written by Jeremiah, most often called the weeping prophet. The book documents his life, and it documents the message that he had to share. It was written during his ministry from 627 to 580 B.C. to declare God's judgment upon his people and to call them to spiritual repentance and to spiritual reformation. God brought judgment upon his people, and I believe that he still does today, even though he has been long-suffering and bringing his full wrath into our presence. Judgment is not a popular subject. It wasn't popular for the people of Jeremiah's day. It's not popular for the people in our day. But God demands that we be forewarned, and that's the message tonight. It tells us, first of all, that about three things I have to mention tonight out of the scripture. The first one, he tells us about the persons mentioned in judgment there in verse 11. He says, now therefore, speak to the men of Judah. Remember this morning I said God gives men the responsibility for the household. He gives men the responsibility for spiritual understanding and guidance for the family. That was very true back in their day. And so that's why he speaks mainly and first and foremost to men. Don't think you're being left out, ladies, because he tells us in just a minute here to the inhabitants as well. But he says, therefore, speak to the men of Judah. This call was given mainly to the men because they were to be the spiritual leaders, the ones that were to be the spiritual leaders of their men, of their family, of their families to God. He tells us then, he says, and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem. The consideration of the message is applied to everyone. It applies to us as well today. It's amazing how the Bible was written back so many years ago, inspired many years before that, and how God has used it to be able to inspire us today. He still has wisdom and guidance for us today. So he points that out to us as we look at the scriptures. He tells us that the correction was being brought to the people through this prophet. He said very clearly, he says, speak to the men of Judah, to the inhabitants of Israel, saying, thus the Lord, thus saith the Lord. The Lord was sharing the message. He used Jeremiah to share the message. He's using me to share the message today. But the message has not changed. God says for us to be obedient. He says for us to be repentant. He says for us to straighten our lives up and pay attention to what he says. Something very, very strange in this message today as we look at what God shares with us about how these people reacted. Don't point your finger too quickly because we too find ourselves in that boat. Not necessarily you, but this world that we live in today. The people that are inhabitants of this world today. And that's what he says, the inhabitants. The inhabitants of the world today turn their back against God. They point their finger at God and say, we don't believe in God. So he tells us today to look at that. The correction was brought to the people through the prophet of God. It was a clear message. It was a message that was from God himself, he says. Tonight, I want you to understand this message is from God. It's not from me. It is from God. Often I get thanks for the message, and I'm thankful for that because I believe God inspires the message to me. But at the same time, the message is not from me. Remember, at all times, I'm just the conduit that God uses to spread the message, to pour it through. You're the one that's the receptive of it. I receive it much longer, many days before you do. God shares it with me and pours it into me many times before I deliver the message. But the correction is brought to God's people. He tells us it's a conscious message for us. That means it is a message that is conscious for us today. We can't look at this message and look back and say it applied to the Israelites and it doesn't apply to me. God says it implies to us that it is for all inhabitants of the earth. That means it implies equally as well to us today as it did the Israelites back then. We need to remember that today. He tells us, Jeremiah said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. I believe today it's more at hand than it has ever been. The scriptures tell us, as we've been studying on Wednesday night, the book of Revelation, that God is sharing with us that it's just over the horizon. We need to be prepared. We need to be ready, because this message was not popular in Jeremiah's day. It's not going to be popular today, but I want to share the truth of God with you today. So he says, the persons mentioned in the judgment. Second of all, he tells us the proclaiming in the message tonight in verses 11 through 14. He says, first of all, in verse 11, the concern. Many times we look at this, we miss the concern because we're always concerned that whatever message is being spewed out or poured down the conduit, we aim it at our fellow man. It doesn't apply to me, it applies to my neighbor. That was a good message to smack so-and-so between the eyes with, but it doesn't apply to me. God says it applies to us all. He says here, look, behold, I frame, which means I devise, evil against you. It is a sad thing when God devises evil against his people. He devises evil against the world because they forsake him. He only devises evil against his people when they forsake him. So he points that out to us. He says, God warns us, I have a plan for judgment against you. That was a forewarning. That's a forewarning for us today. God says, I have devised a plan. I have devised evil to bring against you if you do not adhere to the message, if you don't pay attention to what I've shared. So he tells us here, God's been patient. God's been long-suffering for many years today. I believe he has brought some judgment on our world today, but nothing what this world's going to experience when we're out of here. I believe it's going to be so severe, it is going to be terrible to live in this world and to be able to experience what God has planned for those who have turned their backs upon him. So he tells us to look at that. He says there's a command, clear command. He says, return ye now. Return ye now, everyone, from his evil way, and make your ways and your doings good. God says we're to be aware today that we pay attention to what he's saying, look at our lives, make changes as God speaks to us. God is no mistake or person. God knows what's going on in each and every one of our lives. Amen. You can hide things from me, but you can't hide anything from God. Amen. God knows it, and he convicts us of it. But he says, we've ignored it. He said, you've returned to me because we made our ways and our doings not according to his plan. That is common practice today. The world has no includence of God in their lives. They don't pay attention to anything that God has said. Most people can't even tell you where their Bible is if they own one, and they definitely don't open it and read it. So God says, you've forsaken me. You have turned against me. So he says, repent, return ye now. He says that God will not wait forever. God will not wait forever. I know people think today that God's not coming back. If there is a God, well, he's not coming back. He is coming back. Amen. And there is a definite warning here. God expects immediate action. He doesn't want you to wait until you're on your deathbed and then make a decision to follow him. He doesn't want you as a Christian to wait till you see the skies part up in the heavens and then decide you're going to begin to live right. He wants us to live right today. So he says make plans for that. In verse 12, he says there's a continuance in the sin, even though they know the warning. He says in verse 12, he says, they said there is no hope, but we'll walk after our own devices. Says, we don't care what you say. We're going to do what we want to do. How many times we hear that today? You can warn people. You can tell them that they need to be in church, that they need to be serving God. They need to be actively adhering to what God says. And they say, I don't care about all that junk. That doesn't apply to me. You can buy into it if you want to, but it does not apply to me. There is a day coming when God said every knee will bow, every tongue will confess. And we need to adhere to that today. We need to make them aware of that today. Amen. Judgment is coming. Amen. So he tells us to wear it. He says, remember that God will bring immediate action. people think that they'll be able to have time to straighten their lives up. I'm here to tell you today, when God comes back, it's going to be in the twinkling of an eye. In the twinkling of an eye. That means you're not going to have time to make plans. You're not going to have time to straighten your life up. He may come while you're asleep in the bed. He may come while you're laying asleep outside in the hammock. You don't know when God's going to come back. He says to be prepared, be ready, because he says it will happen. He says that there was continuance of the people. You see, they said there is no hope. There's no hope of our returning. What a sad day when America and God's people will say there's no hope of us returning. There's no hope of us making a change in our life. I deal with people today that tell me that. I invite them to church and they say, well, there's no hope of me being there. I probably won't be there. That's sad. That's sad that they will look at that and realize, even though you've told them the time is short, even though you've told them God is coming back, even though you've told them that God's word says he is bringing judgment when he comes back, that they say there's no hope that I will make that move. That's where we're at today. That's where the world is at today. The people responded to Jeremiah by telling him basically, we're going to continue to do as we have done in the past. You can tell God that. Tell him to put that in his pipe and smoke it. That's what they said. Okay? So he says, God had forewarned Jeremiah to forewarn his people, but they ignored it. He tells us in verse 13, he says there was a consideration of God in the matter. He says this, God says, ask ye among the heathen. Ask you among those people that don't know, don't believe in God. Ask you among those people how stupid this decision is. Ask them. He said, but a man, and he gives them a variable thing here that they understood in their day. He says, who has heard such things that the virgin of Israel has done a horrible thing? Judah, condemned here, was called the virgin of Israel. God said they were his chosen bride. He says, even the heathens did not reject their gods. What that meant was, and he you have to go through here and look at the scripture to be able to understand what he's saying, but it's clear when you see the picture. He said they worship their heathen gods. Even though they don't believe in a living God, they worship their heathen gods. That's true today. We have people out here that worship their boats and their motorhomes and their camping spot, whatever. But they don't spend no time with God. God says they worship what they believe in. He says we need to realize that today because Israel should have remained chaste as a virgin. He called them chaste. That means that they should be as a virgin. They should be pure. They should be without sin in their life. God dislikes our unrepentant attitudes. Just like you just don't like it whenever you tell your children or your grandchildren, do such and such, mind what I say. I hate it when I see a kid looking at me. Well, I don't care what you say. You're not my daddy. You're not my mommy. I wanted to smack them, okay? Go to jail for child abuse. I could do that real easy. Because he says that he condemned them for it. He said he condemned them. They should have remained connected to God. They should have remained pure for God. Sometimes I look at them and I think they are the stupidest people that ever lived. And then I'm reminded of how stupid I am sometimes that I don't take for full recognition all the things that God has done in my life. God did so many things for the Israelites. He brought them from slavery and being beaten and all those things that he brought them from into the promised land. He did so many things for Israel. They were audibly able to hear him speak. They saw his power and his might in so many various ways, and yet they turned their backs on him. We don't see those things today like they did then, but God's recorded them for us. And we're held just as responsible today because we have them recorded for us. So he tells us today that they should have remained chaste. He says God's consciousness of this is different to them than he realizes. What that means is that they think that God doesn't really care and that God just really doesn't pay attention. I hear that so much today. Oh, God knows how it is. God knows that I got this and that going on, and God knows that I'm involved in this and that. People don't have any idea. They don't take into consideration everything we have God gave to us. Amen. I don't care if you're a millionaire today. That first penny to the last dollar you've got, God gave to you. Amen. Whatever we have in this side of eternity, God gave it to us. So he tells us they are not aware of that. They don't realize that God's consciousness of sin is different from the way they look at it. They think, oh, it's everybody's doing it. Everybody's doing it. It's okay. It's no problem. Everybody does it. Nobody's gone to hell for that. God says they will go to hell for it.
Amen.
Because their disrespect of God, their disrecognition of understanding that God is an awesome God, a powerful God, and that he means what he says, he said he's going to hold them accountable. Their sin had caused them to stumble. It had caused them to forsake God's commandments. We need to be careful today, friends, that we don't allow the sin in our life to blind us and cause us to stumble. God's very clear in the scriptures as he tells us that our sins will cause us to stumble. And we need to be very careful about that. Verse 14, he says, will a man leave the snow of Lebanon, which cometh from the rock of the field, or shall the cold flowing waters that come from another place be forsaken? What was God saying there? God was saying that the meaning of this text was that at that time back then, the snows never melted on the mountains of Lebanon. Sort of like out in Colorado. Been out there, man, it'd be 90, 95 degrees driving out there, and you look up on top of the mountains, you see the snow. That's awesome. That's awesome that God kept the snow on the mountains. He said, remember this. He said, I always keep the snow on the mountains. He also said that they needed to realize that God was showing them that he had always controlled the snow. He said, the rivers don't dry up. You know, I was learning while we were out in Colorado this year and what have you, out at Hoover Dam and visiting out there. They told us that they rely mostly on the snow on the mountains to be in Arizona to be able to supply the water to so many people in California, Nevada, different places. They rely on the snow on the mountains, and it's been a drought for the last 7 years. When we were on Lake Placid, I think it was, you could see on the sides of the banks of the lake, as high as that wall right there where it was white from the calcium deposits in the water, where the water level was down that far. They said, they're going to be in serious trouble if they don't pay attention to that. Do you think they've thought for a moment, and they begin to pray to God that God will cause more snow and cause it to be able to bring more water? No, they're fighting over what water there is. They're fighting over who has a right to it. Arizona, California, who has a right to it? God says that we need to be conscious of his power. We need to remember that God puts the snow on the mountain. God's the one that puts the waters in the streams and keeps them from drying up. God is the one that supplies everything we need. That's what he's telling us. He says, remember this in verse 14. He says, will they come, these cold waters, or shall the cold flowing waters that come from another place be forsaken? He said, don't forsake God. That's what he was saying. Don't forsake God. Don't forsake the memory and the understanding that God is in control of everything. Remember that God keeps the snow from melting totally on the mountains. Remember that God does not allow the streams of Lebanon to dry up. Remember that God has always controlled them, and he will always continue to control them. God has always judged sin, and he'll continue to judge sin. There's a day coming when he will judge it once and for all. And he tells us that. He warns us of that. Point three, last point today. He says there's punishment in the judgment. Verses 15 through 17. Verse 15, he says, because thy people have forgotten me, and they burned incense to vanity. Now pay careful attention to what he says. They have burned incense to vanity, and they have caused them to stumble in their ways from the ancient paths, to walk in paths and a way not cast up. What does that mean? That means that God is telling us, because my people have forsaken me, they burned incense to vanity. What that means is, the heathens that he spoke of back earlier worshiped their gods. That's what they did. They burned incense to their gods. Okay? He said, you're practicing that. People today are practicing the ways of the heathen. They're practicing those things that the heathen do. We're taking it as our thing today. So many people today use different things and call it their religion. I'm reminded of one guy that I shared this before. My son was telling me about this guy that he goes out on Sunday morning, every Sunday morning, listens to the Beatles on the radio, drives around in his car and listens to the Beatles on the radio. He says, that's my God. That's my worship. Shame on anyone who uses anything other than God in their life to bring worship.
Amen.
He tells us that you have turned to vanity. You have turned to those things because What's that going to get them? What's that going to do for them? Is burning incense to those idols going to do anything for you when God comes back? No, it will not. God says that He's going to hold them responsible. He says, because they have turned their backs on me, they've forsaken me today. Verse 16, He says, it's promised. He says, I will make their land desolate, and there'll be a perpetual hissing. He says, that means that everybody around will recognize it. Everyone will see it. Everyone will know that it's God's judgment upon their land. Today, we see so many times that our world looks upon things and they say, when a tsunami or a hurricane or a tornado or something happens in our lands, that's God's judgment on them. But does it have any effect upon us? God uses signs and symbols in the world today to help us all to be able to realize He's in control. He's in total control of everything. He said, remember this, the desolation is promised. I will make their land desolate. I'll make them a perpetual hissing. He says that His judgment will bring desolation to their land. You know, we have been, like I said a minute ago, in a drought out west. You realize what responsibility that can bring upon our country today? We feed billions of people around the world. And they're sending a lot of stuff overseas. What happens whenever the crops begin to dry up and we don't know? You remember back in the, what they called the Dust Bowl, back in the 30s and 40s, whatever? They couldn't raise crops. There was a dust went through. The winds blew all the time. They had locusts. We've had some locust destruction around here. And I've been noticing here lately the green beetle or whatever that's on. I'm amazed at how many trees they've cut down. And I'm wondering what that's doing to our ecology, what it's doing to our world as far as our air and oxygen in the world, because they've cut down thousands of trees and are still cutting. So He tells us that God promises desolation. In verse 16, He says, I'll make their land desolate. I'll make them a perpetual hissing. He says, everyone that passes by will be astonished and wag his head. That's pretty bad when everyone that passes by will wag their head and be astonished. He didn't say they'll be wondering. They'll be astonished at what has taken place. All would be astonished at the ruin that had taken place in a country that God had called a land of milk and honey. God called them a place where they live in a land of milk and honey. Judah and Jerusalem would become disgraced. They would become a dishonor. And that they would be an object of scorn, He's saying, to everyone. They'd be an object of scorn. Can I tell you today that I believe our country, as America, is getting to that point? You know, it used to be that everyone respected the United States. Everyone wanted to come to the land of opportunity. And everyone respected the United States. Today, no one respects the United States. Not even people in our own country respect our country. They're walking on our flag. Amen. Yeah. Right. That bothers me. I spent time in the military. I wasn't overseas in battle, but I spent time in the military. And I don't like that. God says that it would be as if there were a mighty wind blowing from the east. They call that a nor'easterner nowadays. He said it would be as if there were a mighty wind blowing from the east, and the people would be scattered and exiled. He said it was like a tornado where the people have no control of it. You're picked up here and you're left over there. That's what He said. So He tells us to be aware of that. That's a pretty good warning. That's a pretty good sign. If you're looking for signs, that's a pretty good sign. So He says to be aware. Verse 17, He says, the disposition would cause them discomfort. He says in verse 17, I will scatter them as an east wind before the enemy, and I will show them the back and not the face in their day of calamity. God would scatter His people all over the world. He would scatter them all over the world, and many would become slaves. They would become slaves. Today, I believe that's partially the way we're headed. I believe that's where a lot is happening. You know, a few years ago, we used to have a lot of good jobs around. Nowadays, there's not a lot of good jobs around. A lot of people that make over $8 an hour are very blessed today. That's what God says will happen, and I believe it's going to get worse. He says, I will show them the back and not the face. What does that mean? That means like if I just walk out the door and leave you sitting here, show you my back. I'm not showing you the face. I'm not showing you the politeness. I'm not showing you the respect of preaching the word to you in such a way that you can receive it. God said, I'll leave. I'll just leave and leave you with what you want. That's what He's saying. So he says here, God promises he'll turn his back upon them. And he says that just as they have turned their backs upon him, he said, I'll turn my back upon you. It's very clear as he looks at the scripture because he says that. He says, I will show them the back and not the face in the day of their calamity. He said, don't straighten up. Sort of like your mom used to say, you know, if you don't straighten your act up, I'm going to wear you out. That's what he's saying. So it's a clear message that God is saying, if you don't pay attention, you're going to suffer the consequences. I'm going to leave you to what you want, but you'll come crawling back to me. I love that movie that was on, I think, Nutty Professor or whatever it was. I don't remember now what it was. That this guy was talking on there, and he was threatening his mother or whatever, and she said, go ahead, Cletus, you keep on. Said, you'll walk over here, but you'll crawl back. Okay? That's kind of what God said. He said, you keep it on. He says, you bring it on. He says, you'll crawl back. I'll leave you there. You'll come crawling when you come back. That's what God's telling us today. He says, in conclusion today, we need to pay attention because there is judgment upon the sinful. No longer can we realize that God has not warned us. He has warned us. He's given us fair warning. I believe this warning applies to us today as well as it did to them back then. God could make no stronger appeal than he made through Jeremiah to the people. I believe it was clear. God pleaded with the Israelites. I believe he's pleading with us today. I believe he is pleading with us today to repent. Turn from your sins. Turn back to me and pay attention, lest you come into judgment. He's clear about that. So I think it's important. God loves us, and God wants us to escape that judgment. He doesn't want to bring judgment upon us. Remember whenever your mom used to say, this is going to hurt me worse than it does you? That's where God's at. He's saying, this is going to hurt me worse than it does you. But you're going to get it. You're going to get it. I think it's clear what he's saying here. We need to obey God's commandments. We need to live righteously according to what he's instilled before us. We need to listen to the appealings of God. We need to pay attention to what he said today. Let's stand. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for the opportunity to share the word tonight. Father, I pray that I've shared everything you want me to share. Father, what a clear message that you've given us out of Jeremiah, Father, that we need to heed your warnings. We need to pay attention to what you've shared with us. Father, help us to do that tonight. Help us to lean upon you. Father, help us to draw strength from what you've shared with us tonight. Father, help us to be more strict about ourselves, Father, and adhering to what you say, paying attention to what you say. And Father, doing it when you answer, when you call, Father, let us answer immediately. And Lord, we'll be careful to give you the praise and all the glory for this time together. For we ask it in Jesus' name. For his sake we pray. Amen. You come and do whatever God's laid upon your heart tonight. I'll be here to pray with you. I think the message has been clear. We need to repent. We need to look to the guidance that God has given us in his word, and we need to repent and pay attention to it. You come.